Good morning. I'm Barbara Coleman, and it's a pleasure to welcome you to Monroe Street Church. We are a reconciling congregation of the United Methodist Church. We welcome all, whether your week has been easy or challenging, whether you wish you didn't have to mow your lawn quite so often, or wish you still could. Whatever journey you are on, we're glad you're worshiping with us. Our mission is our purpose. Say it with me. Our mission is to deepen faith, engage our neighborhood, become an inclusive community. This morning, Pastor Joshua Wynn will bring our morning message. Pastor Ruth Solo is offering prayer. Dorothy Shorter is our liturgist. Christina Davis, our director of music. Pat McCauley is our Angel Wings director, and the Angel Wings Bell Choir will be providing our centering music. The Wesleyan Chorus and the Praise Team will also be providing music. Pat Groves designed our PowerPoint slides, and Cookie Chambers is providing tech support. If you have prayer requests, the pink cards in the pews are there for your use. They go in the little gray church in the corner, which is also there for your offerings. Next Saturday, April 26th, at 6 p.m., the Clarence Smith Community Chorus will be performing their spring concert. Who's ever heard one of those choruses performances? Yeah, they're wonderful, aren't they? If you are available, see Clarence or Chris Davis for tickets. It's time to think about Freedom School. You know that we need volunteers to do many things. There's information in this week's newsletter. You can sign up online to be at the sign-in table, to read to kids and sit with them at lunch, to help Chef Les, and to sit with kids at lunch. If you have questions or would rather sign up in person, see me, please. Lunch Bunchers are meeting next Saturday. Nancy Hatfield can give you more information and can take your reservation. No one expects to become ill or injured at church, but it can happen. Our parish nurses have been so good about maintaining emergency cards, telling us who we should contact in case one of those things happens. Today and for the next two Sundays, you'll have an opportunity to see one of the parish nurses in the back following the worship service to review and update, if you need to, your emergency card or fill one out for the first time. And if you're not sure if you ever did, check and find out. There will be no newsletter on May 12th. The newsletter editor is going to be away, so the May 5th edition will be for 2 weeks. The deadline for those two-week issues is Tuesday, April 30th. And now I invite us to center our hearts and our minds for worship.
Please stand as you are able. How shall we live when we have more than enough?
We have no greater praise to offer than caring for your creatures and creation.
The earth is our teacher, nurturing and tender.
In this hour, O God, nourish us in the soil of your love.
Let us worship God, the ground of all being.
Bless the Lord, O my soul, worship God's holy name. Sing like never before, O my soul, I worship your holy name. The sun comes up, it's a new
before, oh my soul, I worship you.
your holy name. Yes, I will worship your holy name. Lord, I worship your holy name.
If I could have the kids and those who are young at heart, please come forward. So, today's lesson is from 1 John. Imagine that, because we've been in 1 John for a few weeks now. But one of the things that 1 John talks about is this idea of experiencing God, experiencing Jesus, abiding in Jesus as Jesus abides in you, which takes a level of knowing. So let me ask you a question this morning. How many of you, because, like, obviously none of you knew who Jean-Claude Van Damme was the last time that I did one of these. So, let me...
Jean-Claude Van Damme?
Yeah.
Jean-Claude Van Damme?
Yeah.
Van Damme?
We'll talk about it later. I've got some movies for you to watch. But here's somebody that most of you would probably know. How many of you know Mr. Beast? You know Mr. Beast? Silas, what does Mr. Beast do?
He does YouTube. He does challenges to people.
Okay. If you're not familiar with Mr. Beast, because I wasn't until my son started watching Mr. Beast, Mr. Beast does these YouTube videos where he does all these different types of challenges in hopes that people can earn or win money. They're pretty interesting. That's the word I'm going to use for them. So part of your homework this week is to go home and Google Mr. Beast. But, so let me ask you a question, Silas, since you're the one that likes to talk.
It depends.
Do you know Mr. Beast?
No, I do not know him personally, but I know him as, I watch his YouTube.
Yeah, you know of... You know of Mr. Beast. But you don't know Mr. Beast like you know me, right?
No.
Okay. All right. Do you know some things about Mr. Beast? Like, you know he has a lot of money, right?
I don't know. He got it from the bank.
Okay. Well, you know that he gives money. You know he does YouTube. Or is there anything else you know? You know kind of what he looks like?
Yeah.
Yeah, but you don't know Mr. Beast. You see, the point that I'm making is there's a difference between knowing about someone or knowing something about someone and knowing someone. You not only know some things about me, don't tell anybody, because I don't know what's going to come out of your mouth. But you also know me. We have a relationship. And that's what the word abide means. The word abide is really about this relationship. It's not just knowing about God, but it is indeed knowing God. Knowing God. And so you want to know one of the best ways that we can know God? By the way we love. That's how we experience God the most, is the way in which you and I love each other. Let us pray. God, in the ways in which we struggle to love you, help us to love. The ways in which we struggle to love ourselves, help us to love. In the ways in which we struggle to love others, help us to love. May we experience you today by this community and by all the ways in which you lavish your unrelenting love upon us. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Amen.
Thank you all. If you would please stand. At this time, I encourage you to pass the peace of Christ with one another wherever you are. Peace of love. Oh, sorry. No chest bump. Peace of Christ. Peace of Christ. Thank you.
gotta say, that's not the way my mother used to sing it. But it was great. I loved it. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you, Chris. So now let us take it to the Lord in prayer. God of the sparrow, God of the whale, God of the swirling stars, how does the creature say awe? How does the creature say praise? We are in awe, Creator God, about your creation of this earth. We look out at mountains, lakes, and rivers, fields and forests, and we see breathtaking scenes. We watch fish swim by us in clear, clean waters, which are harder to find these days. We see birds building nests in the trees, which are being torn down to make way for so-called progress. We walk through forests and watch small animals scamper, and we mourn the loss of the habitats of so many small creatures. On this Sunday before Earth Day, we must confess our responsibility in the destruction of your creation. So forgive us and help us to find ways to preserve and save this earth. We bring our prayers today for the people we know and love who are suffering. We pray for loved ones and dear friends who are sick, those who are mourning the death of their dear ones, those who are in trouble and see no way out. We pray for the people in Toledo who have lost loved ones to gun and knife violence this week, and for those who suffer from mental illness, who need help before they completely break and hurt others or themselves. We pray for the people of our neighborhood and especially the residents of the tiny homes. We pray for the safety workers in our city, police officers who must make split-second decisions, and firefighters who risk their lives and well-being at every fire scene. We pray for all who work for the well-being of the citizens. We pray for all the people who live in places of war, where there is food insufficiency, housing has been destroyed, and poor sanitary conditions, where children have lost parents, and parents have lost children to weapons of war. We pray for the wars to stop and that weapons will one day be turned to tools of hope and peace. And we pray for one another that we may be better servants of you, O God, as we follow the ways of Jesus, his teachings and his examples, as we make our lives an example after the life of Jesus, as we live in truth, being honest about who we are and what we believe, as we love Jesus as Jesus loved, and take on the love that is God as our way of being in this world. And we pray all of this in the name of Jesus, who taught us to pray as we say, our Creator, our Redeemer, our Sustainer, our Mother, our Father, who is in heaven, holy is your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread. Forgive us our sins as we forgive those who sin against us. Save us from the time of trial, and deliver us from evil. For yours is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen.
Test. Here we are. The song that the praise team is going to share with you today is probably familiar to many of you. Considering my age, I grew up with this song, so I'm thinking, y'all, it's actually a secular song, but I think it really does speak to how to love. And that's what we've been talking about. So. And if you feel so moved, you're looking at those words and you're remembering them and you remember the tune, don't be shy. Just join in.
Scripture is 1 John 3, verses 16 through 24. You know love by this, that Jesus laid down his life for us, and we ought to lay down our lives for each other and others. How does God's love abide in anyone who has the world's goods and sees another in need and yet refuses to help? Little children, let us love not in word or speech, but in deed and truth. And by this we will know that we are from the truth and will reassure our hearts before God whenever our hearts condemn us. For God is greater than our hearts, and God knows everything. Beloved, if our hearts do not condemn us, we have boldness before God, and we receive from God whatever we ask because we obey God's commandments and do what pleases God. And this is God's commandment, that we should believe in the name of God's Son, Jesus Christ, and love one another just as Jesus Christ has commanded us. All who obey Christ's commandments abide in Christ, and Christ abides in them. And by this we know that Christ abides in us by the Spirit that Christ has given us. This is the word of God for the people of God.
Well, the praise team, the choir, and all the music this morning has taken me back to my Pentecostal days. Give me a flag and a tambourine, and I would have been right there with it. Well, if you're joining us for the first time, or you missed a couple weeks or something, then you might want to know that we're in a sermon series called Dear John. You were given a piece of paper this morning, not just a song sheet, but a Dear John kind of letter format where you're able to take that home, look at it, journal with the question, or just sit with the question and reflect upon it. And so we've been in this series for a few weeks now, and we've been looking at what it means to be a Christian, what it means to follow Jesus, and how are we supposed to live this life of faith. Today's message is probably one of the hardest ones I've ever written. I've sat with it for a long time. I do believe it is challenging, and I don't just say that, it is challenging to me, too. And so let me start off by saying this. Ever since Descartes said, "I think, therefore I am," the Western world has been obsessed with knowledge. So much so that Christianity in the West has largely been about teaching people what to believe. Namely, what to believe about God, what to believe about Jesus, what to believe about the Holy Spirit, what to believe about Scripture, the Bible, you name it, and the list goes on and on and on and on. I'll never forget one of my first DCOM interviews ever. If you're not familiar with what DCOM is, let me try to explain it. DCOM stands for District Committee of Ordained Ministry. Basically, it's a committee that meets annually with candidates for pastoral ministry to ask them theological questions. It is a kind of screening process. So I had studied the sacraments backwards and forwards in the UMC. You might want to know there's only two sacraments in the UMC where there's like seven in the Catholic Church. I'd studied them backwards and forwards because I knew that when I sat down with this committee, they were going to ask me specific theological questions regarding the sacraments of baptism and communion. Sure enough, one by one, they began to grill me about baptism, and I had books upon books that I had read about baptism and communion, and I had my 7 points memorized, and I spouted out my answers quickly and succinctly and precisely. Then they grilled me on communion, and again, I had my list of answers ready to go. I nailed it. There was no way I was wrong. I knew that I had passed, and I could not wait for them to say, "Well done, good and faithful servant." Then one of the pastors in the back asked me a separate question. "What do you expect to happen when someone receives communion?" I blanked. I had nothing I had spent all my time and energy on trying to know the bullet points of theological answers. And all of a sudden, my bullet points, my answers were insignificant and inadequate because he was asking me a different kind of question. He wasn't asking me to regurgitate something from a United Methodist book. Rather, he was asking me a more experiential question. And I had nothing. Talk about embarrassing. It was at that moment that I realized that having the right answers wasn't enough. That there had to be more, that I wanted more to spirituality than just some set of religious rules or set of beliefs. In fact, I find that the older I get and the more I practice this faith journey of following Jesus, I must admit I have much more questions than I have answers these days. I find myself like Paul, for now we only see in part. But one day the hope is that we will see in whole. But it was that moment I began to realize that there has to be more to this religion called Christianity than just a set of doctrines and theological statements. Here's my concern. In the West, we have so drifted into head knowledge regarding faith that we have diminished the heart knowledge and the experiential knowledge of spiritual formation. And honestly, it is our head knowledge of God that oftentimes seems to just get in the way, does it not? For instance, think about how many different religions there are and how there seems to be so much conflict between certain religions. Or think about all the denominations in Christianity alone. Do these denominations not exist because at some point they decided they believed something different about God and what Scripture teaches than other denominations? Even non-denom, right? We all know there's that non-denominational down on the street or something like that, but they're a denomination too. I mean, even though they don't want to be, you know? And so they have separated themselves. Think about how much we argue about differences of beliefs in the church alone. And if you don't believe me, let me just highlight a few words to prove my point. I'm not going to make a statement on any of these words. I'm just going to say them. Homosexuality, abortion, immigration. Let me give you some of the things that I have been told from different denominational leaders in the Christian faith, as I was being mentored by some of these folks. Women can't be preachers. Women can be preachers. Divorced people can't be pastors. Divorced people can be pastors. You're not truly saved until you speak in tongues. You're saved at the moment you believe in Jesus. Eating too much turkey on Thanksgiving is a sin. That one, I must admit, I flipped him off as he walked past me. I wasn't as sanctified. I'm just kidding. I'm going to hell for listening to rock music. Good Christians don't cuss. And the list goes on and on and on. And some of these may seem trivial, much more trivial than the doctrines that we hold, like Jesus being completely divine and human at the same time, or like the doctrine of the triune God, the Trinity. However, it is often these beliefs that cause us to begin to pigeonhole each other, that cause us to create our own tribes and to hinder us from actually loving others. Somewhere along the way, we have confused our beliefs about God and what God wants with knowing God. And here's the thing, the two are not the same. Richard Rohr put it best when he said, "We don't think our way into right living. We live our way into right thinking." And yet most of our focus in the church over the last 100 years, if not more, has been to make sure that people have the right beliefs. Mostly, and I'm just going to name the elephant in the room, because it's a big one, but we often will try to overlook it. Mostly the reason why we want people to have the right beliefs is so that we can assimilate them into our understanding of who God is. Don't get me wrong. Please don't mishear me. Please don't misunderstand. Knowledge is important. I love knowledge. I have 2 degrees and I have the student loans to prove it. And good theology is important because bad theology can lead down to some destructive roads. We know that. But knowledge about God can never, ever, ever be substituted for knowing God or experiencing God. The Apostle Paul put it this way. We oftentimes use this passage in weddings, but it's not about weddings. It's not about romantic love. It's about you and me. It's about the dirt and the grime of just normal human relationships. And Paul wrote this to a Corinthian church that did not know how to love one another. And he says, "If I understood all of God's secrets and had all of God's plans, if I had all the knowledge in the world, and if I had such faith that I could move mountains, but if I didn't have love, or if I didn't love others, I would be nothing." Nothing. And I believe that's what John is trying to get us to consider this morning. You see, John makes an argument that we don't hear quite often. John makes the argument that living a life of trust and love is the primary way you and I as Christians, as followers of Jesus, experience God. Instead, you would have, if I were to ask you or ask John how to experience God, we probably would have expected John to go off on some long tangent about how we need to read our Bibles, go to church, listen to Christian music, wear a cross around our necks, leave tracks when we go out to eat, and put a "Honk If You Love Jesus" bumper sticker on our car. They will know us by our bumper stickers. But no, John doesn't do any of that. John goes right for the heart of Christianity. And John says that to know God is to love God by loving one another. John says it this way. "This is God's command, that we believe in God's Son, Jesus Christ, and that we love one another. All who obey these commands abide in Christ, and Christ abides in them." The word John uses for believe doesn't just mean to acknowledge something to be true. That's the mistake we often think of whenever we read John. But it means to be persuaded. to be convinced of something so much that you entrust your life to it. So in this case, what John means when he says, believe upon the Son of God, it means to be so persuaded by God's love that you and I entrust ourselves entirely to Jesus. A few years ago, a friend of mine and I sat down to discuss our church's mission statement. I've heard you guys have done something similar. Part of our mission statement was discovering faith. Sound familiar? Ours was discovering faith. What's yours? Deepening faith. And so we were tasked with giving a simple definition of what discovering faith meant. And I asked my friend, oddly enough, his name was John. I said, John, if you were to put it in your words, what does it mean for you to discover faith? What does it mean for you to discover faith? He paused for a moment, and his face got real serious. He looked down and he said, to me, it means to learn to give all of my life into the care of Jesus. Can I say that again? To me, it means to learn to give all of my life into the care of Jesus. OMG! Is that not the best definition of faith you've ever heard? Or at least it was for me at the moment. And that's exactly what the author of John means when he says, believe. And then he goes on and says the second command is to love. Not just to love in speech, but in action. To be willing to lay our lives down for each other and others, and very few of us, if any of us, will ever be given that chance literally. But all of us are called to do this type of love symbolically. For instance, this type of love requires that we lay down our need to be right. Ouch! Right? Who are my people out there that are like me that love to be right? Right? No one of y'all are raising your hands. You don't. Liars! No, just kidding. It means I have to lay down my need to be right. It means we have to lay down our compulsion to put people into groups, to label them because we think they are some kind of, or because we think we are some kind of gatekeepers for God. Sometimes I feel like the church is so busy trying to figure out how to keep certain people out, while God is just so busy trying to get them all in. You see, this kind of love requires that we let go of the barriers that keep us from loving others and to make people, not our disagreements, the primary focus. Sometimes I wonder how well we would welcome someone that challenged our values and convictions here at Monroe Street UMC. Do with that statement as you will. But think of the very person you would hate to see walk in. The very person that represents everything that you don't stand for. How would I respond? You see, this kind of love that John is speaking of may even require us to sometimes let go of our opinions, or perhaps even our need to argue. In the Gospel of John, chapter 15, Jesus is talking to his closest disciples about the importance of abiding in him. He gives an example of what it means to abide. He says, I am the vine, You are the branches. If you remain in me and I in you, you will bear much fruit. But apart from me, you can do nothing. I thought about this for a while in preparation for this sermon because, let me just be honest with you, there are not very many sermon illustrations for the word abide. It's not an easy word to like just pull a picture up and decide, oh, okay, this is what it means to abide. And as I thought about this, I thought about how a branch doesn't have to worry about having all the right answers, right? It doesn't need to think highly of itself or lowly of itself. A branch just is. It doesn't have to will itself to produce fruit. That just comes naturally from being part of the vine. It's not striving or trying to earn its way. It's just being what it's supposed to be. It just is. It's just there. With no need to prove itself. And when a branch is a part of the vine, it becomes difficult to tell where the vine begins and the branch ends, doesn't it? You know what I mean? That's when it struck me. In the quiet of preparing for this sermon, maybe that's what Jesus means by abide in me and I will abide in you. Maybe Jesus means that we should be one with God and others. That to abide really means to be one with. That in some way when we learn to love fully, we are experiencing a oneness with God and all of creation. Maybe that's why people like St. Francis called the sun brother and the moon sister, because St. Francis began to see that everything is connected. And maybe that's what Jesus is getting at. After all, and just two chapters later from chapter 15, Jesus begins to pray. After he says, abide in me and I will abide in you, Jesus begins to pray. And you know what he prays for? He prays that the disciples would be one. As Jesus and God are one. And then he goes on a little bit further and he prays that they would be one with God and with himself. Maybe that's what it means to love our neighbor as ourself. To see others as an extension of our own being. Think about that for a minute. And just maybe this is what John, the author, is trying to get us to consider, that we are only as disconnected from God and each other as our ability to love. That's why Jesus says, when you welcome the least of these, you welcome me. The goal of experiencing God is to be one with God and all of creation, including you and me. But here's the thing, and it's a big thing. That kind of love can really be uncomfortable. Anybody already feeling uncomfortable? I know I am. And the reason it can be uncomfortable is because it requires me to admit when I'm wrong. It requires me to forgive when I don't want to. It requires me to let go of my own prejudices and judgments of others, the things that I create in my mind.